Welcome back, Brainiacs. It's good to see you. As residency interview season begins, I want to focus this video on how to ace your residency interview, with a focus on medical students applying into neurosurgery. That said, these tips and insights should be applicable and useful for any medical student, regardless of specialty. I hope this content helps you better prepare for your interviews, boosts your confidence, and offers specific strategies for you to stand out and give yourself the best shot at matching at the program of your dreams. But first, a little about myself. I'm an academic neurosurgeon with a clinical practice in brain tumors, and also work actively in clinical and translational research. I train medical students and residents on a daily basis and take part in our own residency selection process for neurosurgery, performing interviews and helping my department form a rank list. In terms of my own experience, I went to medical school at UCLA and completed my residency in neurosurgery at the University of California, San Francisco, with an additional fellowship in endoscopic and open skull-based surgery at the University of Southern California. I've lived and breathed academics my entire professional career. My wife also happens to be an academic neurologist, neurology clerkship director, and assistant program director for her department's own residency program. Between the two of us, we know the interview process inside out and what separates the good from the truly great interviews, including mistakes we've seen medical students make that they may not even realize. So if you think this type of content could help you, stay tuned. And if you wouldn't mind, give this video a like, leave a comment, and consider subscribing if you aren't already part of our growing Brainiac community. I'd love for this content to reach as many students as possible. This video is meant to comprehensively cover everything from top to bottom, including the questions you may encounter, the questions you should ask, what to wear, and how to stand out from other applicants. Because there's a lot to cover, this video will be generally divided into three parts. Number one, how to prepare for your interviews. Number two, how to execute your interviews. And number three, how to follow up your interviews. Number one, before the interview. Preparation for residency interviews absolutely sets you up for success. Just like you wouldn't take an exam without studying, consider the interview a test you're trying to pass with the highest possible score. But the subject matter is you, your experiences, motivations, values, and virtues. You want to step into that interviewer's room with maximal confidence, and for me, that always meant preparation. Your first impression means everything, and because of that, let's start first with what to wear. Plan your outfit in advance. Gentlemen, if you don't already have one, now's the time to invest in your first real suit. It doesn't have to be expensive, but it should be professional and conservative. I would recommend dark, monotone colors like gray, navy blue, or black. Keep the shirt simple with a single color, with maybe a simple pattern, and always wear a tie. I would stay away from excessive accessories like pens, pocket squares, or jewelry, and please make sure you're cleanly shaven or have tidy facial hair. My wife recently told me the story of a male applicant they interviewed who was strong across the board and nailed his interview, but had obviously not shaved for days or taken any effort to comb his hair. Now, it may sound superfluous or superficial, but if that applicant's appearance was enough to make my wife and her colleagues question his professionalism, then that's a big problem that undermined how strong an applicant he was otherwise. Remember, you'll be taking care of our patients soon, and hygiene and grooming are basic but important parts of appearing professional and earning patient trust. It seems so basic, but I've personally interviewed numerous students who couldn't be bothered to shave or iron their clothes. It makes for a bad first impression. Ladies, you should also keep it simple. I'm certainly no expert on women's fashion, so I talked to my wife and here's her advice for what to wear. She recommends a pantsuit or knee-length skirt with hosiery. The suit should be black, blue, or gray, with most women wearing a dress shirt or blouse. Keep your jacket on during interviews, minimize accessories, and keep jewelry simple and not flashy, with neutral nails and your hair neat. Comfortable shoes like low heels or flats are best, and keep makeup natural looking and not overdone. After you've figured out your outfit, now it's time to do some research. Hopefully you put a lot of time and effort into selecting the programs you want to apply to, because believe me, we can tell when an applicant has a sincere interest in our program versus those who just check the box next to multiple programs without doing their homework. Make sure you know the places you're applying to, including who the faculty are and their specialties, and basic details about their training and experience. You will also interview with some or all of the residents, so read up on them and their backgrounds as well. It's also helpful to understand the basics of how a particular residency program is structured by year and what rotations are done and where. Remember that you may also interview with research faculty, affiliated with, or in the department. so it may be helpful to spend a few minutes looking into their areas of research and projects they work on with clinical faculty in the department. You should be able to find most of this information at a department's website, usually under a residency or applicant section. As interviewers, it's also in our interest to make sure you have a transparent view into how our residency is run. We want you to fit in with us as much as we want to make sure we fit in with you. Preparation better acquaints you with the people you'll be meeting and interviewing with. The input of residents, attendings, research faculty, and staff is all under consideration when we create our rank list. You want to impress everyone, and knowing a little bit about the people who make up the department and may be interviewing you is always helpful and shows attention to detail. In terms of preparing for what questions you may be asked, there's not much you can do. We often change up the questions we ask from interview day to interview day, so it's not possible to definitively prepare for the infinite questions you may be asked. So what can you do? Know your subject matter and know it cold. You should know every single aspect of your application inside and out, including being ready to explain every grade, evaluation, presentation, publication, or experience for medical school you may get asked about. I once got quizzed on an incredibly specific finding in a research paper I completed 3 years before the interview and found myself flustered and unprepared. I did a poor job explaining myself because I hadn't reviewed the paper in a long time and ended up incredibly embarrassed. Don't make the mistake I did. And remember that this is your time to shine. The better you are at explaining your experiences, accomplishments, and goals for residency, the better you can convey what makes you special, unique, and drives your passion and excitement for the next step in your training. Speaking definitively and concisely on your application will make you stand out as polished and confident. But don't just be ready to explain your accomplishments, be ready to talk about you. What are you most proud of? What was the moment that made you certain you wanted to be a neurosurgeon? What drove your desire to work so hard to achieve this goal? Thinking about the answers to these questions reveals your values and virtues. When we interview you, we assume you're smart, motivated, successful, and ready to work hard. But we don't know yet what drives you, what your goals for residency are, what life experiences made you who you are, your maturity, personality, your communication style. We want to interview people who are self-reflective, have given serious thought to their motivations and goals, and embody sincerity and compassion for others. Don't forget that we'll be spending literally thousands of hours with you in the hospital and operating room, and vice versa. We may see each other more than we see our own families during your training. So as faculty, we want to make sure we'll get along well as coworkers and professionals. So now that you've chosen your outfit, research programs, and thought long and hard about your values and virtues, the final step in preparing for interviews is preparing questions to ask. Virtually every one of my residency interviewers asked me at one point if I had any questions for them. Rather than worry about asking the right questions, take this as an opportunity to shine and distinguish yourself. This is your best chance to guide the conversation the direction you want. And don't waste the opportunity to highlight your strengths and how you could easily transition into a successful resident at that particular program. For example, if you've completed research in a particular area, don't just ask a general question about research opportunities as a resident. Ask about whether there's protected time to do research, whether or not you could work in a particular lab as a resident or with a faculty member doing similar research, or about grant opportunities you could pursue. These questions all dig deeper, highlight the goals you have, and demonstrate how you'd like to contribute to the department from day one. We want you to succeed as a resident and be the best possible neurosurgeon. So when I hear questions from applicants that hint at how you're planning for success, you've definitely distinguished yourself in my book. Take another example. Maybe you're someone who has skills in teaching or student leadership. Ask about how you can get involved with resident leadership roles, such as being a delegate to the AANS, CNS, or other professional society for your specialty. Or consider asking if there are opportunities to have a formal mentor or to mentor medical students as a resident. Take the extra step to show your interest in continuing the projects, activities, and accomplishments that made you a successful medical student so that we know you're destined for the same success as a resident in our program. Your questions should implicitly and explicitly reveal your motivation and goals. Plan to ask questions that allow you to refer back to your strengths as an applicant, but remember to remain humble. You shouldn't brag or come across as arrogant. You want to appear competent with a track record of success. Number two, during the interview. If you've reached the day of your interview, congratulations, your moment to shine has officially arrived. This should be a day of excitement and execution. If you've prepared for your interviews, now's the time to crush them. But you can't be at your best if you haven't taken care of the bare necessities. Be good to yourself on the day of your interview by getting as much sleep as you can the night before and stick to your normal routine the morning of your interview as best you can. If you normally eat breakfast, don't go into interviews on an empty stomach. Drink coffee if you're a caffeine junkie, get your morning exercise in if that's your habit, but be sure to leave yourself plenty of time to get dressed and off to your interview on time. Be punctual and be ready to make a good impression the moment you walk through the door. Remember, everyone in the department is evaluating you, and the more positive impressions you make, the better. Every department is a little different with how they conduct interviews, and with virtual interviews now becoming more common, expect the unexpected. Your first interview may be a solo session with the chairman, or it could be a panel-style interview with current residents. Rely on the game plan you formed in advance, including the parts of your application you particularly want to highlight, and go into each interview calm and confident. My wife likes to think of interviews as a first date, and I think it's a great analogy in a lot of ways. You're both meeting each other for the first time and trying to gauge mutual fit and interest. Remember that now is not the time to play hard to get. If you've applied to our program, we assume you could actually see yourself training with us and understand how it could be a good fit for you. But we don't know yet how you could be a good fit for us. So the responsibility is on you to use your answers to prove your interest, excitement, and fit in a program. It's normal to be nervous, but remember to breathe and think through your answers. Keep good eye contact. If you've reached the interview phase, that program is showing serious interest in you, so assume you have as strong a shot of matching there as anyone else. Keep a positive attitude and keep your answers clear, concise, and to the point. Gauge the body language of your interviewer and consider asking your own questions intermittently to give the interview more of a conversational feel. You obviously want to prioritize answering the questions that are asked of you, but it's okay to occasionally steer the conversation with a follow-up question or two after giving your answer. Trust your intuition and let that guide you. Number 3, after the interview. Congratulations on getting through what can be a stressful and tiring day. Resist the urge to second-guess your answers or overanalyze how things may have gone. It's normal to feel like you got along better with certain interviewers than others, and remember that some people are purposely trying to challenge and push you, and that how you react may be as important as what you say. No matter what, you're done, and it's time to stay positive and motivated for your next interview. It can be helpful to make a list of the questions you were asked and where you thought your answers were strong and weak. Consider how and where you could have been clearer or things you didn't get a chance to talk about that are important to you and how you might bring these up during your next interview. I can promise that with every interview, your confidence will grow and it will feel easier. I personally think sending a follow-up message to some or all of your interviewers is a nice touch. While handwritten cards are thoughtful, I don't think they're necessary. A follow-up email should be short and sweet and focused on reiterating your interest in that particular program. You can take a brief sentence or two to highlight something from the interview that cemented your interest in that program, but just remember to keep it concise. Even a short message reiterates to me that an applicant has strong interest in our program. You can also use a follow-up email to express interest in doing a second look if you have the time and means to do so. But be sure that you only do this for the programs you intend to very highly rank. It's an implicit way to demonstrate serious interest in a program, so you don't want to dilute the impact by visiting more than a few programs. A second look isn't necessary, but does send a stronger message that a program is at or near the top of your list. We know you're taking time and resources to see our program up close. If you've made it this far, thank you so much for your support. I hope you found this content useful. With the right preparation, execution, and follow-up, you can ace your residency interview in neurosurgery or whatever specialty you've chosen. Remember your value and virtues and let those guide your answers. The interview is your time to shine, so bring confidence and competence to the table, and I'm certain you'll do well. Thanks again, Brainiacs, for joining. Don't forget to leave a like, comment, and subscribe. Keep an open mind, and I'll see you next time.